This is Dan Schneider. This is Actors on Acting, and Richard Brestoff is the man in front of you. He is an acting teacher. He had a career in acting on television and film, and we will speak about the art and craft of acting in a moment. Richard Brestoff is an actor who appeared for many years on mostly episodic television, some film. If you watch film, television rather in the 70s or 80s or 90s, you probably might find his face familiar. I know that I most knew you for two shows on television in the 70s and 80s that were related to the military. One was Operation Petticoat, which I remember was sort of like MASH on the water. And then the other one was Tour of Duty. You had, I think, a recurring role there. And I remember after China Beach, that was probably the only other Vietnam show worth watching, Vietnam War show. But as I like to usually do, I like to give people a few minutes to talk about who they are, where they come from. So if you could tell a little bit about your background, if you're from an acting family, how you got into acting, and what you're currently doing.
Thank you, Dan. Yes, I came from a family of mostly musical artists. My mother was a lead singer with the Jimmy Dorsey Orchestra after Helen O'Connell, who was the most famous singer for Jimmy Dorsey. My dad was a classical music violinist who became a big band conductor of his own. So my mother also hosted television shows here in Los Angeles when I was growing up in the late 50s and early 60s. So I was around TV studios and cameras a lot. She did a lot of commercials as well. Her main talent was her voice, which was extraordinary.
So you're currently a professor at UC Irvine, is that correct? And you've written a number of books on acting. If you could talk a little bit about the writing of the books and what you do as an acting teacher.
Sure. Yes, I'm a professor at UC Irvine. Currently, I'm head of the acting program there. I really never intended to write any books. I have five of them out. I sometimes look at the bindings and I see my name, but I don't know really how that happened. I didn't write them because I was a university professor. Particularly, I wrote three of them before I ever started teaching at the university level. I was going to teach acting for the camera in Seattle, and I looked for a book because I came out of the university system and they generally require a book, so I thought, well, I'll look for a book to teach from. And there were some good ones out there, particularly the famous Tony Barr book. But none of them really corresponded to my everyday experience of shooting. So I started to write some notes to myself to teach from. And it was kind of evolving into something longer. And I took it to a bookstore in Seattle. Cinebooks, was it called? I can't remember now. And I showed it to the owner, and she read through it, and she said, "Do you mind if I pass this on to some literary agents that I know?" And I said, "No, I don't mind." So she got back to me and said, "They would be interested if you would actually finish this book." So in about 2 weeks, I finished the book. It became my first book, The Camera Smart Actor. And oddly, I had looked around for a book that would take you through a day of shooting, what you actually go through in a day of shooting. And in the 100 or whatever years it is since the founding of cinema, I couldn't find a book that took you through moment by moment, shot by shot, shooting a scene, which was very odd. I thought, well, okay, so mine is the only book that does that. It can't really be true after all these years. But I got a publisher through these literary agents who found a publisher, Smith and Krause. We never did find a book. There has to be another book or two or three or four that discuss, you know, a new person coming onto a set for the first time. And I thought, well, I'll just hold someone's hand because it was a shock to me. First time I shot something out of NYU and I had my master's degree in acting, and I got a part on a PBS series called Our Story, which was about the Revolutionary War. And we shot. I'd never shot anything. At NYU, film courses were not part of the actor training at that time. And I went to my trailer and I changed my clothes to go home, and there was a knock on the door. And this guy said, "Okay, we're ready for you." And I said, "Ready for what?" He said, what do you mean? And I said, "Well, the scene was on the call sheet. We just shot the scene." He said, what? Can I come in there?" And I opened the door, and he was aghast. And he said, "What are you doing in your street clothes?" I said, "I'm going home." He said, "You can't go home. Get into your costume." Meanwhile, his walkie-talkie is going off saying, "Where's Richard? Where's Richard?" And I said, but the call sheet says we shot the scene. We just shot the scene." He said, "That was just the master." I said, "What's a master?" He went, "Are you kidding me?" I said, "No." He said, "Well, I don't have time to tell you the history of motion pictures or how these things are made. We're going to be here half the day, three quarters of the day, maybe the whole day, shooting scenes from different angles." So I went, "What?" I had no idea. I had no idea. So I changed, got into my costume, and went back. From that moment on, I remember nothing. I was shell-shocked. And I realized that if the camera was now suddenly in a different spot, do I need to cheat over because the audience has moved? Did I need to cheat over to open myself to camera? I had no idea what was going on. Of course, that would be a very terrible idea. So I was humiliated. When it aired, a casting director, it was aired in New York at a theater before it went on the air, actually, this was a screening, looked at me as if I smelled really bad. I ran out of the theater in New York where it was showing, and I started to head toward the East River with the idea that I was going to throw myself in the East River because I was so humiliated. I was tears streaming down my face. And I couldn't find the East River. I didn't really know where it was. I just kept running east, I thought. After a while, I got so tired, I thought, well, it's probably really cold in there, too, and I don't really want to throw myself in the East River. I guess either I throw myself in the East River after that, or I just say, you know what, I'm not God's gift to acting. I have a lot to learn about the camera and all that, and I guess I'll try to do that. I'll try to learn more about what this medium is about. That book, that Camera Smart book, came as like my mission in life. Like, hey, you guys, you coming out of the theater, you need to know this stuff, because I didn't. And it was so humiliating. I misled my parents. I told them it was on a different day than it was on, so they never saw it. It's a horrifyingly, terrifyingly bad performance. And ever since, I teach acting for the camera because I don't want anyone to ever be as unprepared as I was. No one should have to go through the humiliation that I did. And that book really came out of that experience.
Well, I want to talk a little bit about some of the other subjects of some of the books, because in some of the prior interviews that I've done, you're my 11th acting interview, some of the people have touched upon people like the Adlers and the Strasbergs and the method acting and whatnot. I want to talk a little bit about some of the differences. But first off, it was interesting because an hour or so ago, I was watching some videos. There were some videos of you talking on Vimeo and on some other backstage or something. And one of the videos actually linked to your videos as a watch next thing was a roundtable discussion between like Morgan Freeman and Nicolas Cage, Peter Sarsgaard, and two or three other actors. And they were asking, the question asked was, is acting art? Which seems to me such a silly question to ask, because of course it's an art. As someone who teaches acting, do you get that kind of question? And what prompts someone to even argue if acting is an art or not? Certainly it's not a creative art, but it's an interpretive performing art.
Well, no, I mean, I don't get that question from actors or students. I have gotten it from the university. One of the criteria by which they judge whether you should advance from assistant professor to associate professor, which means tenure, to full professor, which means something else, is creative activity. And I have been told at some members of a committee who are not in the arts questioned whether or not acting was creative. Of course it's creative. You just said it wasn't. It's a recreative performing art.
Yeah.
But yes, I guess, but it's more more well faceted than that. Look, if you look at an architecture's blueprint, can you live in it? Can you walk into it? No. The words on a page are essentially that structure. They are a blueprint. And bringing that into three-dimensional life is a creative act. Building that thing that you can live in, to me, is a creative act. All kinds of decisions have to be made that the playwright is hoping you're going to make, that the architect is hoping you're going to be able to read that blueprint correctly, but you can't live in it. So a map is not the territory. You look at those blue lines and you get on that road and it's dirt, or it's a detour. There's a sign there. You have to get on the road with it itself. That's what actors do. So to me, that's a creative activity. That is an art, without question.
Yeah, what I meant was that someone like Wholesale couldn't just totally off the top of the head, you know, do Richard III or something. So there are the words. So what I meant was that it's primarily having little moments of creation based off of someone else's. It's interpretive. For example, you would interpret Richard III differently than any other actor, for good or ill. And let me also ask then about acting theories, because as I mentioned, a number of the people I've talked to before have mentioned some of the big names, the Adlers and the Method and Lee Strasberg. First off, when you act, and I don't know if you're still actively acting, but what was your take on acting? Were you someone who had to reach deep in and remember the time that, you know, Aunt Betty shamed you in front of the family to get the tears flowing? Or is it some of the actors that said, well, I just pretend that my child has died, as it says in the script, and I cry? What is your way of getting to the meat of what the situation your character is in?
Well, it goes back to my training, really, which was at NYU grad school. And that was primarily Peter Cass and Olympia Dukakis. And I very much follow what I was trained to do, and I teach it, and I always say, it isn't me, this is Peter Cass, and this is Olympia Dukakis, because they gave me a career. I wouldn't have it in.
Had a little audio and video difficulty, but Richard, you were talking about Olympia Dukakis and your teachers, so if you could continue.
Yes, Peter Cass and Olympia Dukakis. Peter's background came out of the group theater, so all those people, Stella Adler, Lee Strasberg, Sandy Meisner, came out of the group. And Peter's mentor was Clifford Odets, who, of course, was the most famous playwright to come out of the group theater. So our training at NYU was really based in that experience with the group theater. However, it was neither Meisner repetition exercises, nor was it going back into your past in Strasberg's method with emotional recall. It was none of those things. Olympia had an exercise she did with us where she would hand us a scene which we had either read ahead of time or not. Sometimes we had never seen it. And the idea was to connect with your partner, and if you felt kind of flirty or something with your partner, you then have a connection between the two of you. You'd look down for your line, and you had to say the line from the feeling you had before you saw the line. So the line wasn't running you. You were in charge of the line. You weren't here at this point in our training to serve the play or serve the text. You were there to speak from your actual, authentic first reaction to your partner emotionally. So, if you're feeling flirty, kind of, and you look down and the line is, I hate your guts.
Yeah.
You have to say it. You can't do this. If you did this, she'd jump all over you. You feel kind of flirty with your partner and you look down and you see the line and you go, I hate your guts. Then the line changed you instead of you being in charge of the line. So if you're catching a first impulse and you really are allowing it, and we did this for a year in two chairs. Eventually we would get up, but we were mostly in two chairs. And if something very emotional came up for you and you tried to block it or censor it or manipulate it in any kind of way, make it more than it was or less than it was, she would go back and she would get a little bit under your skin. And as soon as you either got mad at her or you got upset about something and started to maybe tear up, she'd say, put it on the line. So she'd stimulate something, then you'd go back and you'd say it to your partner from the authentic feeling you had, no matter where it came from. The idea being that we are not, so a lot of actors will say, we're storytellers and we're here to tell the story and all that. I bristle at that because I feel that the author is the storyteller and that we are the story experiencers. We're the ones going through it. So the basis of this was to actually speak from authentic experience, whether it served the play or it didn't. So that was our whole first year of training. But when it came to the second year, they said to us, so now you've been working on being authentic, emotionally engaged with your partner, reacting in the moment with them, but so what? You now need a craft to know when and where to place these things. Peter would call it a clothesline. It's essentially the group theater spine that comes out of Stanislavski. But he called it a clothesline, that all those pretty emotions need to hang on something. Otherwise, they just drop to the floor and have no effect. So you see scenes where people cry a lot, but you don't get moved because it has to do with structuring where and when these things occur. That's the craft part. So there was the horse and the rider. And the horse was all instinct and intuition and emotion, and that was the first year of training. But the rider needs to be able to guide those things in order to win that race, because if the horse just feels like going and having some grass without a rider on it, it's not going to do anything. If it's just following any instinct or impulse, it's not going to serve the purpose. So it was a very good way, I don't know if you can see this or not,
yeah,
but they described complicated as this. But what we were trying to do was marry the horse and the rider together, and they called that complex, and that was this. So I could visually see, because sometimes the horse and the rider, the craftsperson and the emotional personal person, could clash, but it was a pretty small move to make this be what happens for an actor. It was astonishing training, and it accounted for a lot of the success of actors that came out of the NYU program. So it's probably closer to Stella Adler and Uta Hagen. Interestingly, Uta Hagen and Peter Kass were in Clifford Odets's Country Girl together on Broadway. He was acting and she was acting. Peter actually directed the very first production for Odets, but it wasn't on Broadway. When it went to Broadway, Odets directed it and asked Peter to play one of the parts. And when I was researching Uta Hagen, I thought, boy, those two, there are some things here that Uta Hagen is saying that I've heard come straight out of Peter's mouth. Mm. And I looked to find a connection, and I found it at the Country Girl.
Yeah, I know Odets is one of those writers from the Depression era that has, I think, been lost to a lot of the younger generation. You hear of Arthur Miller and O'Neill and Tennessee Williams, but Odets is, I think, very underrated in comparison. But let me talk about the authenticity thing, because I know some actors, both those that I've known personally, who've done mostly dinner theater or whatnot, and some of the actors I've talked with prior in this series, would say, well, acting, you know, if you were hired, say, to play a psychosexual killer like Ted Bundy, or if you were hired to play Joseph Mengele, or if you're straight and you're hired to play like Al Pacino played in, what was that film where he played Swingers or something, Cruising, that was the film, the controversial film. And that's outside your experience. How do you bring authenticity to someone who's a psychopath if you're not a psychopath, or someone who's a racist if you're not a racist, or someone who has some sexuality that's different than yours if that's not something that's, you know, systemic to who you are?
Well, there's a couple answers. First, I'll say that Peter used to say this too, and I'll probably quote Peter a lot because I owe him so much, and Olympia. We have, you know, Horace, the Roman philosopher, said, nothing human is foreign to me.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning, there is the range from Hitler to Gandhi is here. Peter would say it even goes further back because we were once amphibians. Mm-hmm. So phylogeny recapitulates ontogeny, whichever way it is. And so all of that, the reptilian brain, which we still have, should be available to us as human beings. Now, supposing you have to play Hitler. Look, you describe them as racists, as psychopaths, but that's not how they see themselves. Mm. What you have to find is how they see themselves. Hitler was the messiah to himself. I was thinking about playing Hitler at one point, so I read a bunch of books, and something stuck with me because, as Richard Dreyfuss has said, you really can't play a character well that you can't empathize with in some way. Well, I'm reading this passage, Hitler, a guy who had walked into his office, but then Hitler had an inner office, and he opened the door, he got past the first person. Hitler apparently was, I don't know, standing or sitting, with a gun in his mouth, saying over and over again, but I have to do these things, I have to. And he closed the door and walked away. I thought, oh my God, he's aware that what he, because we say a monster, we paint with these brushes like we're somehow not that. And somehow under the right circumstances, we would never be that way. But I'm telling you, everybody's had those feelings. We get murderous over somebody that doesn't close a Coke bottle.
Yeah. Road rage.
Yes. As a psychiatrist once said to me, he said, you know, it's not that if someone hits you, you want to hit them back equally. You want to hurt them 100 times more. That's why somebody insults you, somebody pulls a knife, escalation. Somebody who pulled the knife, the other guy pulls a gun. It goes up and up and up and up and up and over nothing. Paying for a beer in a bar. Those rages, those feelings, those things from Hitler to Gandhi are inside of us, and everybody justifies it. So it's difficult to find the logic of a Ted Bundy, but it isn't impossible.
Yeah. So now acting, though, is one of the arts that, yes, you can do a one-man show. I remember seeing on PBS, was it Hal Holbrook did Mark Twain? He was brilliant in capturing those moments, but most acting is actors with other actors playing out scenes. And you're going to, in any production or run of productions, you're going to come across an actor that either is maybe not just flat out not good enough of an actor, or maybe they're an actor that you're just not in sync with because their methodology of approaching a scene or something isn't in sync with yours. Some actors have told me, for example, just yesterday I was speaking with Stephanie Kramer, who was on the television show Hunter, and she, you know, had mentioned that, you know, my job as an actor is to do my job. If other people can't, you know, hold up their end and whatnot, that's for the editors to edit around. But I would think when you're on stage, and let's say, you know, maybe you're doing a Doll's House, and I'm just using some famous things so people can grasp onto them, and you're playing Nora Helmer and her husband, and you're the husband, and the husband is sort of clueless to what she's going through. If she's not able to convey, for example, her inner state as the main character, you may, as the husband, it may be more difficult for you to convey that you're not getting that state. So where does that synergy come from? How do you keep up your end of the acting bargaining on stage in that moment? That, and we're talking stage now, not film, that can be edited around. How do you keep that moment real For me, art is getting to reality. People use the word truth, but I think they really mean reality. How do you keep that momentary reality alive if you're not feeling a connection with your partner on stage?
I think that it's difficult. It's better if there is that connection. I mean, obviously. But if it isn't there, then I think you jujitsu the moments a little bit, and in that you endow them with what you need them to be doing. So let's say I'm supposed to be in love with Nora, and I'm supposed to be showing it to her, and the actress is not feeling it with me. It's a little bit monotone. The engagement with me is withdrawn. I decide in my head that she loves me so much that to actually show it to me would shatter her. I just jujitsu the moment to give me what I need. And it will work about 95% of the time. There is the 5% where anything I've tried just doesn't work. And it's not pleasant.
So in other words, you try to take it, if an acting partner or partners maybe are deficient or not up to what you would consider a good moment, you try to incorporate their deficiencies in actor as possibly something the character is missing, in other words.
Right. I mean, I have to play, and Olympia would always say this, I have to play what's going on in front of me. I can't try to hallucinate some kind of thing that isn't actually happening. So I interpret what's going on in front of me the way I need to meet my needs.
Now, how about when you have a really great scene, though, and maybe this is more in film rather than, say, a classic stage play. You've got maybe a great scene, an expository scene where either your character or the character that you're playing against is doing something, and something calls for, you know, something to be done A, B, or C way, and you've done it A, B, and C, and now it's the fourth take, and you're going, can we try X, Y, and Z instead, rather than just slight alterations? Do you find that most directors are amenable to that? When you sense a scene isn't working, do you think that it's obvious to the other actors or the director as well? Or sometimes are you unaware that maybe the scene is working, but you're not feeling it as an actor?
So I do think, answer part of your question, I do think the actors and the directors do know when something isn't going right. Sometimes, however, we're wrong about that. I've asked for certain takes to be done again. A director once took me into the editing room, not the editing room, the screening room, to look at dailies and said to me, which one of those do you like the best? I said, well, that one's the best. He said, right, that's the one I printed. And then the one you don't like is the one you asked for me to do again. So I was right and you were wrong. And that taught me plenty, because one felt really good and it wasn't as good. It didn't play as well. It's an inexplicable thing that you can feel terrific about a moment and it isn't playing particularly well. We can't be outside ourselves and inside ourselves at the same time, which is why that outside eye is so critical. What was the rest of that question?
You basically answered that. I know I've asked a couple of times this before too. I know, especially with stage, and I look at stage acting, theater acting, because it goes back to Rome or even before, as sort of the primary acting, that's acting at its rawest, you have the live interaction of a crowd and whatnot. And that's not to denigrate television or film acting or acting, just in videos online. But sometimes I know, for me, probably the moment in, and I've probably seen 30 or 40 stage plays over my lifetime. And the one moment that is always in my mind, unfortunately, is a bad directorial choice that was made when I saw King Lear in Minnesota about 20 years ago, where Lear is wandering on the heath, losing his mind, and the fool comes. And the fool, for some inexplicable reason in his version, was naked. And in Minnesota, during the late fall or winter. It's cold, and everyone was just noticing that the damn fool had shrinkage. And I always just remember this 20 years later. I couldn't tell you anything about any other act or what happened because of that one terrible directorial choice that just sunk the whole play in our mind. And it wasn't the fault necessarily of the actor, but so there are going to be those circumstances, I guess, where a poor directorial choice is made. Do you ever, as an actor, you know, if you were asked to play the fool naked, let's say, in Lear, you say, but why? I mean, I don't understand that. I mean, yes, you're hired to do it, and you're going to have to do it if you want the job, but, you know, what happens in a situation like that when you can feel the iceberg coming and you're the Titanic?
Was memorable. I have discussions with directors. I generally come in with a lot of choices made. I want to bring something to the table, and then I'm amenable to other ideas. I will then try to maneuver a director toward mine. I have ways of doing it. Now, that situation, which is a lot like Dreyfus's in The Goodbye Girl, where he has to play Richard III as gay with a lisp, and he won an Academy Award for that. But I would probably just not do it. I probably wouldn't go out on stage naked. There's a line there that I just... I wouldn't do it. And if they had to replace me, they'd have to replace me. That's happened one or two times in my career.
Now, would that be just because it's wrong for that role, or are you talking nudity in general? Like if you're cast in Hair or one of those 60s plays where there was nudity, are you against nudity in general on stage?
No. I'm against my nudity on stage at 66 years old.
Well, yeah, but let's say this was 30, 20, 40 years ago when you were just starting out.
Maybe. I mean, yeah. I was with the Magic Theater in Berkeley, which was a pretty avant-garde place at the time. And there was a lot of nudity in the 60s, and I was putting little angel wings on the back of naked women when they were going out on stage so they could be naked angels. And I did do a scene for a student film at NYU with no clothes on. That was... okay, and I'm not against nudity. I think it generally doesn't accomplish what it's meant to accomplish. I think it just distracts more than it actually helps. I think it's used a little too often, but I have seen it used effectively, and I think that there are times when it's okay. I think the walk in Game of Thrones, to use a contemporary example, of Cersei... with no clothes on, because of the level of humiliation that nakedness brings, that I think brought home a depth of feeling that wouldn't have been there had she had some clothes on.
Yeah.
So I do think it's appropriate sometimes. But the going out on stage in that situation, I would, if we couldn't maneuver around it, I would leave the production.
Yeah, when I spoke with a fellow named Philip Aiken, who runs a theater company up in Toronto, he made an interesting distinction. He said that he distinguished nudity between nudity and nakedness, and said that nudity is just taking off your clothes, whereas nakedness is taking off the clothes, but also bringing something different sort of to the table, stripping yourself to the emotional raw core. And he says too often nudity is used just for, you know, that effect of, ooh, there's so-and-so naked, whether it's in film or whatnot. You know, I think of like the film that Halle Berry won the Academy Award for, Monster's Ball. And I you know, that scene with her and Billy Bob Thornton is all over the internet. And I'm not going to complain about seeing Halle Berry naked, but to me it seemed a totally gratuitous scene. And it goes on for 3 or 4 minutes, and she's getting it from behind, she's getting it this way, that way. And it didn't add anything to the development of the character. And you know, that, to me, and I compared it to, for example, I don't know if you saw the McQueen film Shame with Michael Fassbender, where he's walking around naked in his apartment and goes to urinate in his toilet bowl. And so you see his you know, his long shaft hanging as he goes, takes a piss. But this is someone who's in their home, who's just wanked off watching porno, and he's going to take a piss. And you get a sense of his loneliness. It wasn't sexualized in the sense of being there. It depicted the character's loneliness. And so do you think that nudity too often then is used as a crutch, as I would suggest it is in Monster's Ball, rather than a deeper portrayal of whatever ails or is afflicting the character in the moment, as I would say happens in that McQueen film?
Yeah, I mean, I would be in complete agreement with you on that.
Yeah. And would you also say, too, like, that's often with violence, and I'm not talking from some, like, bullshit moral majority stance, but oftentimes when you see violence, I mean, if you watch a Sergio Leone film, you have that stylized violence, and you get the characters looking at each other or something, but too often it seems to me you can get, it's better to leave the imagination. You know, the old thing about you don't want to show the monster in its full. It's scarier to not see the monster. In the same way, if you're playing Ted Bundy, to use him as example again, we don't have to see him slicing up the women parts and tossing them underneath trees or wherever he dumped the bodies or whatnot. Just having that thing where he encounters someone and you know what's going to happen, and then we cut to him 2 days later smiling after the body's been disposed of, to me seems generally 95% of the time more effective. Do you think there's just that lowest common denominator titillation for sex and violence? And if so, how do you handle that if you're going into a production, say on stage? Do you tend to shy away from that if you can?
Well, I agree with you that the violence, it not only does it detract from the story and is actually often less effective than more artistic ways of conveying it, but it also kind of inures you to it after a while. You just sort of shut down in some kind of ways, and you sit there and you look at it, but it doesn't really have an effect anymore. And I think that's an artistic failure. I recently played Shylock in The Merchant of Venice, the New Swan Shakespeare Festival in Irvine. And he is trying to take this pound of flesh from the character of Antonio. And the moment of the knife coming out, we wanted to make a lot out of it. I think because the magnitude of the deed is so enormous that you need to see it start to happen. And we spent some time, and the director was very smart about taking the knife, confronting Antonio in a courtroom, just kind of maybe 12 feet away, asking me, what would it be like to try to push that thing through breastbone or whatever it would be? You want it, but what does it actually feel like to do it? And I started fiddling with the knife in my hand, re-gripping it and gripping it. I was kind of in a breathing kind of spot of rage and also, I don't know what you would call it, just anxiety. And I circled around behind him so he didn't know what I was doing, but the audience could see me. And for some reason during rehearsals, I decided I should start a Hebrew prayer. And I started that, but I still hadn't raised the knife. And the other actor, very smartly, in response to this Jewish prayer that I was doing, started the Lord's Prayer, which I didn't want to hear. I clapped my hand around his mouth, raised the knife, and started with all my strength toward his heart. Boom, sudden. And Portia stopped it with this huge cry, but I was breathing a bloodlust. And the other guy was just freaked out too, and I was inches from his breastbone. And it was theatrically thrilling, I think people say, and it probably was. I mean, if I had watched it too, it would probably have like shocked me. But that's what it was meant to do. There's no further, it doesn't do anything. We don't go any further than that. But the idea that this was about really to happen was powerful enough that it drove the rest of the story. So I think you can do these things in these very smart ways. But of course, the Greeks, you know, didn't allow violence on stage. It was the Romans that said, yeah, let's do it on the stage. The Greeks, your messenger comes in and tells you kind of what happened. So I think it can be very effectively done, very beautifully done. Here's another example. I may be going on too long, but the director, Bard Scher, did a production, I forget, it's Titus Andronicus, or it's one of them, where these guys rape this girl and cut her tongue out. And I thought, well, I've seen productions where they tumble around and they kind of simulate rape and they kind of simulate cutting her tongue out. What Bart did was one of the highest achievements of directing art I've ever seen in my life. He, as they came toward her, there was a pin spot suddenly on her face. Everything else went dark. And they were kind of maneuvering around her. And there was a purple light, beautiful purple light, about 10 feet above her head. And she just looked up at it. And the most beautiful, serene-sounding music came on. While somehow in the dark they were raping and then they did, you know, go into her mouth. It was riveting. He wasn't really showing what they were doing. He was showing that the victim has to go out of their body in order to endure this.
Yeah.
That was an insight, and he translated it into directorial behavior that was absolutely stunning. That is high art.
That reminds me of the great scene in Taxi Driver after Travis Bickle has taken Cybill Shepherd to, De Niro's character has taken Cybill Shepherd's character to a porno film, and she, you know, disses him and dumps him. And then he's in some shitty, grimy New York hallway at a payphone trying to call her. And you can hear from what he's getting her answering service or whatnot. And they're telling him bullshit. And he's like, oh, yeah, well, can you give her? And then the camera pans away from him on the phone, and you can just hear De Niro's voice sort of, yeah, yeah, and you can hear the emotional distress, but the camera doesn't want to look at this pathetic moment of the character, because even the camera wants to give him that moment of privacy. What you just said there does strike me as a good choice, because it's something we don't, all of us have known at some point, whether it be just being bullied or whatnot, we know what it's like to be a victim of some kind of violence, physical or non-physical, and we also know what it's like to be lonely. So we don't have to necessarily see it. We can imagine it better. The darkness and the light makes us imagine things that we couldn't show on stage. And in the same way, by looking away from the Bickle character, we can get the intensity of his loneliness even more. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
Let me ask about the 4 to 6 or 8 weeks prep that usually goes into bringing a drama to stage. And I haven't asked this of many of the other people, because only one or two of them have been involved directly with a lot of direct theater stuff. But suppose you get like a new play, or I don't know, maybe it's if you're doing Shakespeare or Arthur Miller or something that's been done often before. You know, you go through the preparation, you get the actors, and you're going through the scenes and whatnot. To what degree do you then go through your run-throughs, you're going through the scenes, and how many times you go through something and say, well, if we came in from the left, the stage left, maybe it would be more effective, or, you know, like you were saying with the playing with the dagger, how, to what degree, to what percentage, or how many times do you have to go through a scene before you get the way it's going to work in this production of whether it's a classic play or a new production? How important is that 4 to 6 or 8 weeks of, you know, preparation?
Well, it's crucial, really. And you say 4 to 6 to 8 weeks, but these days, and it's been true for quite a while, most equity shows get 3 weeks, and it's really 2.5 because half a week is spent in tech, getting lights and sound and everything else in order. So it's been shortened because of time considerations, and it always comes back to the money spent by producers to put these things on. So if you're cast early and say rehearsals don't start for a week or two or three or four, actors are learning lines and making choices and doing things before they hit the first rehearsal, the first reading a lot of times, because the time isn't really there. And frankly, I don't go to opening nights unless I'm celebrating a friend's performance. I'm more likely to go during the middle of a run when it's had a chance to marinate a little bit and own it more, rather than the surface memories and blocking that hasn't found its organic home yet. It's a real struggle, and it's extremely difficult to deal with. Mike Nichols made the point that what you really ought to do in an ideal world is rehearse a play for a couple of months, or rehearse a play for however long it takes, up to where it's ready to open on Broadway, then walk away from it. Don't open it. Walk away for 2 months. Come back, do a couple of brush-up rehearsals, then open it. Because those 2 months away from the play is when the hookups from the brain to the rest of the body all unconsciously occur. And we don't have that luxury. Mike Nichols might have that luxury, might have had that luxury. But mostly nobody's in that position aside from Mike Nichols. But he's right, because again, when I played Shylock in Merchant of Venice, we did it at one point in one theater, and then there were months that went by and did it in an outdoor theater. And everybody who had been in the first production, we didn't do many rehearsals before we put it up again, was leaps and bounds better than they were when we first opened it. Again, it had time to steep, it had time to marinate inside. And then all the hookups were made and everything felt organic and true and real. Again, this is why I don't go to openings, because I'm not really seeing the play as it's going to be later. Walter Kerr used to go opening, the critic for the New York Times, then he would go back in the middle of a production and re-review it. And it was one of the most brilliant strategies a critic has ever had, because he allowed you as a reader to see how something had grown over time, and that maybe your first experience with it wasn't really the one you would have if you went again. It was just wonderful. No one does it anymore.
So how do you then judge as an actor, say, a character that you're going to get? And is it easier, for example, let's say if you were doing Willie Loman, or you're doing a brand new character in a brand new play that's opening, do you ever, as an actor, have you known other actors who maybe feel the weight of, playing, a classic O'Neill character or something? Is it easier for you as an actor to come to a role and make it your own if you are in virgin territory?
You know, it's a two-edged sword. It's there's no history around a new character, so you're creating it, and that's a wonderful thing. There's also a little bit of worry that have you been blind to something that's obvious that someone else would have picked up. On the other hand, if you're playing Hamlet, and I was in Sam Waterston's Hamlet long ago at Lincoln Center in the 70s. And I know Sam Felt, Richard Burton, who he'd seen, and Paul Scofield, and this long history of playing this part, and it weighed on him. But also, there is a history of discoveries that have been made that might be extremely useful to you that aren't there in a new character that you're creating. One example, when I was playing Shylock, there's a point where they say, do you have the scales ready to see if it's a pound of flesh? Is the scale accurate? And he says, I have them here, and I would gesture toward it. Well, one time during the middle of production, I was looking at another edition of this play, and there was a footnote that said that such and such an actor had actually lifted it up and shown the scales. And I thought, that's too obvious. That's stupid. But that night I went to the theater, and I, instead of gesturing toward the scales, I said, I have them here, picked them up, and held them up, and there was an audible gasp from the audience. And I thought, oh, sure, of course, to make this real to them, lifting it up and showing them that I was going to measure out a pound of flesh, that's much better than what I was doing. That's only because there was a history of performance that I thought was a pretty good idea. Actually, I thought it was kind of a stupid idea at first. I did it ever since. Mm. So it cuts two ways with those things. When I've originated a part, I have felt ownership. But I've also felt, I wonder how my friend so-and-so would do this, or oh, for somebody else had been cast, would they find something I'm missing here? What am I missing? So those thoughts also go through your head. They can't be going through when you're performing it. But when you're rehearsing and thinking through choices, there's some trepidation.
Again, had a little technical difficulties, but I'm back with Richard Brestoff. I had just asked you, Richard, about keeping, whether taking on an established role or a new role is more interesting. But let's say you're doing a performance and it's run 88 times or 112 times or whatever it might be. How do you as an actor approach, especially on stage, if you're doing the same performance over and over again, how do you make that walk around a table more interesting or keep it fresh? How do you make that witty retort, if you're doing Oscar Wilde, still witty? I mean, yes, the words are there, but how do you as an actor keep revivifying a role?
Well, it's one of our hardest challenges, I will say. But I was told something a long time ago. It works for stage and it works for film. I was told it in relationship to shooting film. Because once again, like the stage actor, we're doing, if you're lucky, we're doing a number of takes. And then we're doing a number of takes from different angles. So you wind up doing the scene or parts of the scene a bunch of times. And I'd gotten up to take 17 or 18, and I was a regular on a series at that point, so they would allow this. As a guest, you would not get this. And I was getting tighter and tighter and tighter and more upset with myself. And I came out for like the 17th take or something. The words wouldn't even come out of my mouth. I was so upset. I had to just scream to release this tension out of my body, and the next one was a take. And a very experienced actor came up to me and said, don't use their numbers. If they say, actors have their own numbers. If they say take 18, it's take one. And I said, I can't convince myself of that. He said, no, you don't have to, because your brain will now tell you the truth of what I'm about to say. You have never done take 18 before. It is the first time you're doing take 18. Mm-hmm. I was like, well, that's true. He went, right. So in that sense, you haven't done it before. You've done take 17 before. You haven't done take 18 before. It's the first time. On stage, you're always trying to do something better. So if I have to walk around that table, or I have to do that witticism of Oscar Wilde's, and it went really well last night, I'm not going to try to recreate it, but I'm going to try to have learned something about the timing there on the witticism, or where I accented a syllable or something that worked so well the night before. I might try that. But I have to be experiencing the moment in the moment. And I will, as one of your interviewees said, a woman whose name I forgot, I will give up the laugh for the truthfulness of that moment with that actor in that space at that time, because we've never been there before tonight. So I saw Jason Robards in Moon for the Misbegotten with Colleen Dewhurst on Broadway, and he has a speech in the third act that's very self-deprecating, and it was astonishing. I was astonished. As a student, I went backstage. I had to just tell him what he'd done. But I chickened out and I left, and I came back the next night. Now, these are pretty expensive tickets, and I didn't really have the money, but I found it somewhere. Peter may have paid it for me, I can't remember. And I went back, and the monologue came. I was waiting for it. And it was brilliant again. But it wasn't quite at the level that it had been the night before. This time I went backstage, and I did knock on the door, and he did open it. I'm standing there, stage to the low bars, and he says, you an actor? You look like an actor. I said, oh, well, I'm studying at NYU. And he said, come in. So I walk into Jason Robards' little dressing room thing, and I'm standing there. I don't know what to do. And he said, what do you think of the monologue? And because I had said, you know, I was here last night to see you, and I came back tonight, and that called me, and he said, what do you think of the monologue tonight? I said, it was great. It was brilliant. He said, no, what did you really think compared to last night? I said, well, he said, it wasn't as good, was it? I said, well, it was really, I mean, it was amazing. He said, that's right. It was really close. He said, here's the difference between an amateur and a professional. An amateur varies like this. Can you see this?
Yeah.
A professional, I have to vary. I can't do what I did last night, eight times a week. But when I vary like this. That's the difference between a professional and an amateur. And let me tell you something. It was your second time. But everybody in that audience besides you, pretty much, it was their first time seeing it. They don't have anything to compare it to. They don't know that last night it was a little bit better. So for them, if they come back and they compliment me and say how great it was, I'm not going to say, yeah, but you should have seen it last night. Yeah. I'm going to say thank you so much because it really did mean something to them because they have no idea what happened last night. You do. They don't. And I really took to heart what he was saying. Things can vary, and they do take to take, and they do night to night. But that audience, that time, especially in the theater, don't denigrate what they went through. They had an actual experience with you, and you don't need to tell them that, oh no, you missed the great one from last night. You just thank them for what they're saying to you. And yes, vary, you have to vary a little bit, but it's always new. So another part of that show, he was better than the night before, just not the monologue.
Yeah. But Robards was self-aware, and that's the thing that seems to me the importance. He's aware of those minute variations that even maybe a good critic who's sitting in row 24 maybe may not, even if he had come back twice, may not have been. And you as an actor could sense something slightly different or slightly off or slightly better. And as you say, if you think of the whole performance as a terrain, maybe in Act 3, that's where the hilly part is and the Badlands are in Act 1. And the next night it might be reversed.
Right. Right. Well said.
Yeah. So now let me just ask this final question here, and then we'll talk a little bit more specifically about your career as an actor rather than some of this theoretical stuff, and we'll do that in the next segment. But obviously there's the divide that I generally ask actors about between comedy and drama, and the two takes on it are either that comedy, it's harder to get a laugh than it is to get a tear from an audience member or a viewer. And a lot of people will say, well, comedy is harder on the actor. On the other hand, there's what I call the Woody Allen take, who when I think it was after he did his first drama, Interiors, in the late 70s, he said something like, drama is sitting at the grown-ups table, whereas comedy is more or less, not for children necessarily, but you have that idea that comedy is somehow vaudevillian. And of course, there's a difference between the Three Stooges and, a well-written, say, Bob Newhart show. Where is your take on comedy versus drama? And let's also parse it out, because there's different types of drama and there's different types of comedy, too. So it's along a spectrum.
Yeah. It's something I've thought a lot about. I haven't come to any particularly brilliant conclusions about it. Sometimes I feel comedy is more dependent on timing.
Yeah.
And character behavior. But then I think to myself, yeah, but I don't know that it's easier to get a tear than a laugh. A genuine tear also is dependent on timing. And I guess I would say that when I tear up, it has to do with being caught a little bit by surprise by the genuineness of a depth of feeling. It doesn't have to be that they're crying. It can be that they're very much trying not to cry and putting a brave face on it. It starts to break my heart. I think that the drama, this is awful probably to say, depends on choices. And comedy depends a little bit more on timing, even physical comedy. And one or another generally comes more easily to an actor than the other. Not always true. Cloris Leachman is equally brilliant as a serious dramatic actress and as an hysterically funny character. So there are those people that can do both. Laurie Metcalf now, again, is a master of both of these things. Meryl Streep, people don't really know, but I was in a production that actually didn't go, but of Henry V, and she was playing Catherine, the queen, the French queen, who's trying to learn some English. And at a first reading, she had every single laugh. We were hysterical. This whole company was hysterical. At a first reading, I've never before or since seen anybody do that with that dexterity and ease and timing. And the world kind of doesn't know this about her because we see so much dramatic material and so much transformative character playing. But she has an equal gift as a comedian, which was shocking to see. So some people have that. I guess... There's also a surprise element in drama. It's there in comedy too, but it's something that they call the Kazan transition, where I turned on the television one time and a guy's house had burned down. It was a new show. And he's standing in the midst of like nothing. His house had burned completely to the ground. And the newscaster interviewer said, well, how does it feel, you know, to have lost your house? This awful kind of question. And he's smiling. And he's saying, well, you know, we lost everything. And, you know, as you can see, there's just this brick fireplace that's left and everything else. And the only other thing that survived, and he bends down and he, out of the ashes, he picks this thing up. He said, you know, is this metal frame, sorry, that had a picture of my daughter. Sorry. And, oh, it's, if you saw it as a monologue, you'd say, yeah, we lost everything. And as you can see, everything burned down. And that's not what he did. And Kazan noticed this. He said, it's the surprising moment when it creeps up your back. It's not where transitions, where actors put transitions. That's not what real people do. It's delayed or it's ahead of where the actual transition was. His was delayed until he picked up that frame that had a picture of his daughter in it. The picture was gone. Mm-hmm. He just had the frame left. That happened. That's a surprising reversal. And that kind of surprising reversal really is critical to get a tear out of an audience in a drama. Again, like I said, I haven't thought this all the way through because surprising reversal is also an essential component for comedy. So this is a conundrum that actors feel, and they always feel stronger in one than in another. And it doesn't mean they're going to get the laugh. It doesn't mean they're going to get the tear. Yeah. That night, that behavior, what happens, and you rehearse it, and you rehearse it, and you rehearse it. And then as Olympia once said to us in the stage, the audience is your final teacher. They'll tell you what's working and what isn't.
Yeah.
And that's what we miss when we shoot, unless you have a live audience for a sitcom.
Yeah.
You don't know. And it used to be that the director would be by the camera and you could kind of tell, get a little feedback. But now that they're over at Video Village looking at monitors, there's no one there's no one representing even the audience anymore. So it's doubly hard for the film camera actor that way.
Well, let me just follow that up with a question about what I call full body acting and the difference between, and I don't know, have you watched a lot of foreign films? Are you familiar with Kurosawa and Bergman? And one of the things about a decade or so ago, after growing up being a typical American, just watching American film, I went out of my way to watch and buy a lot of the Bergmans, Antonionis, Kurosawa, Ozu, Fellini, etc., and some lesser names. And I found it was a revelation to me, not only in just the more daring nature of a lot of the best of the classic films, even versus the best Hollywood films, with exceptions of a Kubrick or an Orson Welles, but the actors seem to have much greater range or freedom given to them by the directors on screen. A couple of scenes that you may be familiar with, I'll just point them out. And there's a famous film called The Virgin Spring. It's one of Bergman's earliest films. And it's basically about the peasant's daughter gets raped, and the peasant, played by Max von Sydow, vows to get revenge. It was later remade as Last House on the Left, a famous slasher film in the 70s. But in the film, the Sydow character is standing by the spring, the virgin spring, the water, the stream, and he's musing on his daughter's death and sort of, I guess, vowing revenge. But we see the full Sydow against the stream in the woods, and we don't see his face. We just see the slump of his body, sort of the resolve, and we sort of maybe hear his breathing, if I recall correctly. And we know that he's going to get revenge. In America, we would get close up, we'd get the eyes tearing up. Then I think of, for example, there's a great film, Yasujiro Ozu, best known for Tokyo Story, but another great film of his is Late Spring. It's about the marriage of the daughter of a widower. And the widower, played by a guy named Chishu Ryu, who is a great Japanese actor, at the end, his daughter gets married. He has a monologue where he tells him that happiness is something that you create. It just doesn't come. And he goes back after the wedding, and he's peeling an apple by himself, and the apple peel drops to the floor, and that's basically the end of the film. Those two scenes would never happen in American film, and yet both of those are so much more poetic, so much more, to me, showing that restraint in both the director and the actors can be so much more. Yet, with the exceptions of the Cassavetes or the Kubricks or the Wellses, you really don't see that in American cinema. Do you think that the European or the world style of acting, if you want to call it that, is somehow different from the way American actors are taught? Because you were talking about master shots and this, and when we get a conversation, we get face as each character talks. If you could go on about that a little bit.
Well, I do think the American tradition is distinct, and that there are European traditions that are distinct even from each other.
Yeah.
Well, one thing they have in common a lot is body and movement work. So mime in France, Grotowski's work in Eastern Europe, there is a tradition of commedia, Italy, and even in Germany, there's a tradition of movement, and we teach it in our schools, but not to the level that they do in Europe and Eastern Europe, or even really close. There are some places that do, and of course the Japanese kabuki and no theaters, where there's tremendous emphasis on the physical, not at the expense of experiencing the role or of emotion in the role. And we really don't have that a whole lot. In the British tradition, there's the music hall that Charlie Chaplin came out of. Keaton, I think, set a kind of standard for physical acting that was unique in American cinema and translated to the theater as well. I too hunger for more lingering master shots. There is a trend in Hollywood over the last decade, well, 5 to 10 years, of eliminating masters altogether. I think it's a mistake. I know that Mark Harmon on NCIS insists on having masters. He's right. Woody Allen will do that. He's very influenced, as you know, by Bergman and other European filmmakers. I think there's a matter of trust in the attention span in the European cinema and stage that we don't have in this country. The fast cutting, the fast pace, it's America, it's race cars, it's quick, it's fast, and you have talking head and talking head and talking head and talking head, and we're ping-ponging overs or we're ping-ponging close-ups. And we use a master to go in and out at the beginning and the end, more or less, or we eliminate it altogether, or we shoot it, we don't use it. It's a lack of trust in both the attention span of the audience, and we're so sponsor-driven, and we need to make such an amount of profit. And Woody Allen has a deal where he took artistic control over profit. I know this because I worked for one of his producers who was telling me about it. So his films are different, and some other people's films are different. Coppola in the 70s and Scorsese, there's more trust in the art of making a film and in the level of restraint. As you say, Stanislavski said that the final polish, if you want to call it that, on an actor who can rage like George C. Scott or be vulnerable like Brando or this or that, need to go all those places. But the final finish on an actor is restraint.
Yeah.
And we've forgotten it, and we've forgotten how to artistically do it. And the Europeans have been doing it for a very long time in cinema and on stage as well. And I have my difficulties with some of the pacing. It's even, some of it's too slow for me even. But it is distinct, the American acting style. And it's taken over a lot of acting around the world, but a lot of these places have not lost their traditions. Our audiences are different. So we toured a play to Poland in 2003 or 4, something like that. And I was told that when you perform for them, it will be a different experience than when you perform in America. And I thought, well, an audience is an audience, so okay. We went there, and particularly in Warsaw, but in two of the other towns as well, the minute they start to sit in the theater, they're not talking. They're leaned forward, looking at the stage in silence. I was told, partly because, both under the Nazis and under communists, secret messages were being semaphored through actors' performances and directorial choices on the stage. So you went because it was a matter of survival to pick up some of these messages. Well, we started this play in Warsaw, and we were never even close to as good as we were, connected and hooked up as we were, in any venue in the United States. And it was the audience's level of concentration on everything we were doing, word, movement, whatever it was. They were looking in a way and paying concentration in a way that I've never experienced in my life. And I thought, oh my God, audiences aren't just audiences. Audiences that have been oppressed, audiences that have been under the tyrannical boot are paying attention to these artists, and they thought of them as artists in different ways. So afterward, no autographs. They hung around to talk about the play. They hung around to talk about it with great deference toward the actors, but listening in a way that people don't listen here. They want an autograph or they want a selfie. There was no such thing. It was, we are participating together in an artistic event. You're the artist, and I need to talk to you about what happened up on that stage and what it meant and what do you think. And these were intense conversations that went on for hours in some cases at a bar afterwards. Not like when we go to a bar here, to Joe Allen's in New York or wherever it is, and hang around and talk about our agents or casting directors or whatever. It was, I knew I would never have that experience again. and I never have, but it taught me something about the way they approach their art, both as an audience and as performers, that I didn't know.
Yeah, it's interesting. The Kurtosky reference reminds me of the great scene in My Dinner with Andre, where Andre is talking about, I think it's they're dancing around the forests in Poland or something, and having a bacchanal there. But you bring up a good point, too, and it's one I've often said to young writers. I started out just writing poetry, and I think generally writing in the last 30 or 40 years, especially MFA-sponsored writing, is atrocious because it's forgotten that art is about communication. We are communicating something, whether it's writing or it's acting, and there has to be an audience. As Whitman said, a great artist has to help cultivate a great audience. And what you just said is a great example of where the audience influenced the actors, and you get this feedback loop. And I think that's something that's missing, especially when, and I don't want to go off on writing because we're talking about acting, but when we talk about a lot of postmodern writing, where you get this self-referential masturbatory style where the self, me, rather than you're trying to, even if you're talking about yourself, confessional poetry, you have to make it, you have to open an access to that audience, because when you do, the audience will, especially in something as immediate as acting, will give you that feedback, and you can sense whether it's that reptilian brain sensing that, developed to sense predators, you're sensing eyes upon you, and you know, I've got to raise it up a notch here. That last line, my next line, I've got to hit it.
I couldn't agree with you more. And I really wouldn't have known this had I not traveled to Poland to do that play.
Yeah. Well, let's end this segment. In the next segment, I want to talk more specifically about your career. But again, we can use some of your experiences as examples to go off a little bit. So again, let's just end it here. So I'm speaking with Richard Brestoff. We spent about an hour or more talking about acting as an art, theory of acting, and some specific examples. But now I want to focus more on Richard Brestoff, actor, rather than acting in the general sense. Looking at your IMDb listings, and maybe there are some things that are gone, and we'll talk a bit about your stage work too. It's interesting that we're talking about all of these sort of highfalutin theories, and your first listed entry was, as you mentioned, Car Wash, and I remember that as sort of coming at the end of the blaxploitation era, sort of a comedy out of that Cooley High kind of vein. That was your first role then, I guess, on film, and how did you get that? How did a white guy end up in a mostly sort of black casted film?
Experience was that awful PBS series called Our Story, which was the horror show of my life. This was the first film I ever was in. And yes, IMDb is not entirely 100% accurate on credits, but it's pretty close. Car Wash, I was asleep in New York in a small apartment. I was understudying Bill Atherton and Ron Liebman in a new John Guare play down at the Public Theater for Joe Papp. And I got a phone call Sunday morning from my agent saying, can you get over to the Sherry Netherlands Hotel at 11 o'clock or something? It's for some film called Car Wash. And I said, no, it's Sunday. Can't you leave me alone? I mean, I'm going out Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday, not realizing. Lucky I was that I was going on auditions that much. I just did it for granted. And I don't I get it someday? Well, you know, they want to see you for this thing at the Sherry Evans Hotel at 11. I said, well, I don't know. And I think I hung up. And I stayed in bed. I thought, you know, no. And then my conscience started working on me. I got up. You know, reluctantly and taciturnly put on my clothes. I don't know where the Sherry Netherlands Hotel is. They said, just walk across the park from where you are and you'll find it. It's where Jackie Kennedy stays. So that didn't help me. I don't know where Jackie Kennedy stays. So I walk across the park. Again, I So I go over there, and I go to the desk, and I say, I'm here for some kind of audition for a movie. Oh, yeah, third floor, fourth floor, whatever. So I go up there, and I meet this director, Michael Schultz, and it was the strangest thing in the world. I sat on a sofa. He had someone else there with him. I no longer remember who that was. And he said, can you walk black? And I said, well, what do you mean? I stood up and I said, do you want, like, you know, really exaggerated? Do you want a little more subtle kind of thing? What? He said, that's good, that's good. And he had set up a little condenser microphone and some books. And I think I did, must have done some dialogue, or maybe it was an interview, I can't remember. And he said, okay, thank you. I said, well, thank you. I thought, this is the stupidest Sunday I've ever spent. I left. And I, Tuesday, I was due at the public theater, because Monday was dark. Tuesday, I was due at the public theater. But Sunday evening, I got a phone call from my agent saying, can you fly to California tomorrow and be back in time to cover Bill Atherton and Ron Liebman in the evening for Tuesday evening? I said, well, why? He said, well, they wanted to do a screen test for this car wash thing. I said, well, I guess. Are they going to pay for the flight? Yeah, they're going to pay. Okay. Well, okay. So I still didn't know what this was. I didn't know what this movie was. I didn't know what it was. I get on a plane. I fly out to L.A. Cab driver takes me to Universal, to the Hilton there. And a cop comes and picks me up and takes me over to where I'm supposed to be. And I kind of spend the day, there's no screen test. I just sort of spend the day rehearsing with these guys. And they taped off this soundstage, like they said, this is a car wash. And the whole thing takes place at a car wash. And you're the son of the owner. And I don't remember too much about what we did, because I think we were off script. We may have just been deciding whether the chemistry was good with the guys who were already cast, and me and Sully Boyer, who was playing my father in that. And then we went into a room. And this room had about eight people in it. One of whom was a casting director whose name I won't mention, because this isn't a nice story. And he said, look, so you're our guy, so we're going to just keep you here, and you give us the keys to your apartment, we're going to go in there and get your stuff, and fly it out here. And I was like, well, wait a minute, I have to be at the public theater Tuesday night, I have a contract with Joe Papp. He says, you know, listen, you little pisshead, Joe Papp, we fucking own Joe Papp, okay? And I'm like, what is going on here? The guy to my left turns to me and says, is it a matter of ethics? Because I'm with the ethics department here at Universal, and it's really not a problem. And I'm thinking to myself, there's no ethics department at Universal Studios. Are you kidding me? But I'm shell-shocked. So I'm saying, fine, I got the part, and the director was there. And he just sort of nodded his head. He was staying kind of neutral. And it said, then I go back to his casting director who's running it. And he says, look, fuck Joe Papp. We want you in this film. You're gonna take an understudy at some stupid theater over a part in a movie? I said, look, want me to call Al Pacino right now? I'll get him on the phone. He'll tell you what to tell him. I'll tell you about Joe Papp and whether you should take this movie. I want to call him. I'll call him right now. I said, he said, look, we're going to use you like we do. We use you like toilet paper, and then we flush you away. Now, I suddenly became very calm. I said, I want a ticket to New York tomorrow morning so I can be there to understudy, cover the actors I'm supposed to cover. What? I said, I want a ticket. Fly me back tomorrow morning so I'm there in time to understudy. But listen, you bullshit. You better be ready for that plane to turn around in midair and come back here. We own Joe Papp. You know why I say this? Universal owns Chorus Line. You think he's going to screw it up? I said,
I just don't like Hollywood putting the screws to me very much. Boy, was I right. He said, yeah, well, fuck you. You better be ready to turn around and just come back here. And if we have to break into your apartment in New York and you'll give us the keys, we'll break in, we'll get your stuff, and we'll bring it to you. Well, I've never been talked to like this in my life before. Read any stories about this sort of thing happening like this? And I was calm and cool and collected, and I said, I'm on a platform. The same cab driver who had brought me, for some reason, was outside. I walked into the cab. He goes, how'd it go? I said, I got the part, but I'm not sure I'm doing it. He went, wow. Took me back up to the thing. I flew back to New York. Joe Papp came to me and said, I got a call. And they want me to let you out of your contract in some stupid movie. I'm not letting you out of your contract. You can get 2 weeks notice. I said, well, they told me they don't have 2 weeks. You know, they'll lose it. He said, well, then you lose it. I said, okay. I told Bill Atherton backstage. Bill Atherton then went into Joe Papp's office. And they had a fist fight. This is New York theater. They had a fist fight. Bill Atherton yelling, let the kid go, you little fuck. Let the kid go. It's his chance to be in a fucking movie. God damn it. Boom. I hear this thing. Boom. Yeah, the fucking boom. I'm sitting outside thinking, Jesus, God, don't have a fight. I didn't get in the car once or not. Bill Atherton comes out. He says, I fixed it for you. And he goes out there. Joe comes out. He knows the show. He says, you can give 1 week's notice. If they won't go for that, then forget it. So I called my agent. I said, Joe will give 1 week's notice. They called Universal. Universal agreed. And that's how I got in the movie.
Hmm.
Oh, here's the part I forgot to say. I said to the director, how did you get my name? He said, well, I was at my birthday party here. And at my birthday party was Peter Cass, your acting teacher. And I was complaining about having a hard time casting this role. And he said, you could do it.
Hmm.
So Peter, essentially, got me my first big movie job.
Well, that's a good anecdote. Having some technical issues again, but hopefully we can get through the rest of the show. That was an interesting anecdote. It reminded me of something that Carol Demas, a Broadway actor, was telling me. I think it wasn't Joe Papp, but it was another famous Broadway director, and she had to actually go to a SAG. I guess it was an equity trial against him there. Just funny hearing those behind the scenes story. As I mentioned at the start of this interview, the two series that I was the most familiar of you being in were two military series. In the late 70s, Operation Petticoat, I remember, was on for a year or two. And I remember initially, I think I tuned into it because I thought it was like a reboot of Petticoat Junction from the 60s. I remember it had John Astin, who was from the Addams Family, in it. And it was sort of a McHale's Navy kind of show, but I think it had was about nurses or something. Tell me a little bit about that series, which I guess is pretty much, you know, it's not really spoken of that much. And how did you get that part?
Well, that was a normal audition process. So my agent sent me on this audition. I did that. Then I had a call back. Then I think I had another call back. And I think I had another call back for the head of the studio. Then there was what's called the network call back, and I had never been on one of those. So in this case, it was going to ABC headquarters in Century City in Los Angeles, which is all corporate offices. It doesn't have any creative feel to it at all. And I went up there, and at that point, you have to have already signed a deal to be a regular on the series for 7 years. So I knew what the deal was. I knew what I would be making. I knew that all the options were on their side. They could drop me in any 6 month period, but I was signed on for 7 years. I had no options. That's the standard series contract at that point. And there were two other guys up there. I figured it's down to us three. It was was when they opened the door to the room where I was going to do this final audition for the network, there were about 50 to 60 people sitting in this room. Now, I've never had a film audition. Maybe six people in the room, writers, a couple, a director, a casting director or two, at the final producer call. I sort of was in shock when I saw this huge group. Luckily, I was reading with John Astin, who was very experienced, and he just whispered to me and he said, "Just keep your eyes on me, Richard, keep your eyes on me." So I turned to him, and then again, the training of experiencing something with the other person and letting the audience in on it. We did the scene we were supposed to do. I left not knowing if the other two guys had done a better job or were more, you know, what they were looking for or whether I was or not. And a friend of mine said, "You have to schedule something really important to do after this. So take your mind off it, like go to Disneyland or play basketball or have dinner with so-and-so. Have an event after this event. So this isn't just the event of the day." Very wise. And I went with a friend of mine and we shot hoops for a while in some playground. And then I got the call that I had been cast in this series. And John Astin called me and he said, "Now look, I have assurances from them because I'm not doing this otherwise. This will be much more like MASH than Michael Navy." So I said, "Oh, that's great." Because I love Michael Navy as a kid, but I didn't want to be in a retread of Michael Navy. What did they do after assembling the cast? They hired as their script supervisor the script supervisor from Michael Navy. John was furious. We were all pretty furious. And after the first season, they got rid of every single regular except me and Jim Varney and Mindy Nod, and every other single person was gone, deciding that it was really must be the cast's fault. When in fact, it was that the writing was back in the Michael Navy time.
Yeah.
It wasn't a great series. It was a very big learning experience for me. And then I did the second season with a different cast, and then it was gone.
Well, I looked that you then did some Lou Grant, The Associates. You did a Brady Girls Get Married TV movie. I guess that was you weren't one of the guys that Jan or Marsha married, were you?
I don't remember.
No?
I may have been. I don't remember.
Okay. It's interesting. I see that you did in 1983 the Steve Martin movie, The Man with Two Brains. Yesterday when I spoke with Stephanie Kramer, the actress, she was also in that movie, and she barely, I think, recalled being in that. Did you have any scenes with Martin in that movie?
I did. Yeah, he was fascinating. I am largely cut out of the film.
Uh-huh.
Reiner felt so bad that he gave me fourth billing in the movie. And it's Steve Martin, Kathleen Turner, David, and then me. Told me I'd get wonderful residuals because he felt so guilty. It was a part he was going to play himself, but I auditioned for it, and he said, "You'd be better in it than me." It's probably not true. That was really a kind of joyful experience, partly because Steve Martin was an entirely different human being than I thought. I expected the wild and crazy guy and to goof around and have some fun with him and stuff. And he's the shyest, most introspective person I think I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah.
He would sit in his chair between takes, completely quiet and with his eyes sort of half-lidded and just breathe. And then he'd get up and the walk to the set was completely introspective, and as soon as he hit the scene, he turned it on, and then he would leave, sit in a chair quietly. You couldn't strike up a conversation with him. No one did. And then one day, he and Carl Reiner said to me, "Hey, do you want to go to the
Norton Simon Museum, look at some art on our lunch break. I didn't know that Steve Martin was a huge art collector and fan. Yeah. And I thought, God, I'm such a little guy on this thing. I'm not going to go with the director and the lead actor. What if I'm needed around here or something? I mean, I can't be gone with these guys. I don't know what to say to them. So I said, no, I'll just hang around here. And they went off, and I should have gone. I probably should have gone. It would have been probably a memorable experience. I just was too intimidated, I think, by who these two were to pal around with them. So I did the thing, and the crew was laughing at some scenes pretty hard. And then they have to shut up because we're shooting. And I had dinner with Kathleen Turner about two or three nights later, and she said, do you think that scene's still going to be in the picture? I said, well, yeah, the crew was laughing. She said, that's what I mean. I said, what do you mean? She said, yeah, when the crew laughs, they're too inside. It's not stuff that a regular audience is going to find funny. I just think that's going to be cut. That freaked me out. Went to the screening. I was invited to go to this, wherever studio it was. And Carl comes out and he says, so I had to cut some of you. And he looked straight at me. And I said to my wife at the time, I said, he looked just straight at me about being cut out of this. So I'm watching scene after scene go by and realizing, yeah, I'm in it. But about a third of what we shot is in it. Afterward, Carl came over to me. Aside from John Astin, maybe the nicest man I've ever met in show business or anywhere else, he said, I'm so sorry. I had to cut it. It just wasn't that funny.
Yeah.
And I thought, he said, no, that's not what he said. I'm sorry, that was a different thing. He said, I had to cut for plot. And so some of the funny stuff had to go. I did know at that point that a filmmaker's job is to create the illusion of continuous action, which is you sacrifice for plot. Plot is number one, even in a comedy, which I thought was kind of ridiculous because the Marx Brothers doesn't work that way. but that's what he said to me. He said, but I fixed it so you get these wonderful residuals. Well, all these years later, I mean, I was able to take a trip with my wife, my new wife, to Monterey and do the Central Coast of California, just on a residual from Man with Two Brains, in which I hardly appear.
Yeah. Well, let me talk about the difference of a movie cast versus a television cast, both as a regular and a guest star. Because in looking over, you did things like Soap, Remington Steele, Hill Street Blues. I knew of an actor named George Dixon who died a couple of years ago who was a regular for the first season of Hill Street Blues. He played one of the captains there. And then I see you did Night Court, and I interviewed a woman named Karen Austin who was on the first season. And I've heard, you can read between the lines, sometimes casts are constantly feuding and it's not a place, you know, it's sort of a hostile place to go on to, whether it's a movie or a television series. Have you ever experienced that? And you don't have to, again, name the actor or the director who is a prick or something. But have you ever been on a cast or worked on a television series where you went on and you're like, oh boy, I want to do my shtick, get out of there and give me my residual check? And, you know, like, can you, like I said, keeping anonymous, give maybe an anecdote?
You can always tell when there's a tension on a set. I have avoided that a couple of times. Things didn't go well, and interestingly enough, the movie I'm thinking of did very badly at the box office and pretty much ended the star's career. It's very difficult when you run into those situations. And I have to say, I haven't picked it up very much, even if it was going on. When you're guesting, it's usually harder to pick it up. On Petticoat, there was some trouble, but it came from the producers. And it hurt John Astin planting stories about how difficult he was to work with, which it's one of those exact opposite lies where you just take what's wonderful about them and decide it's the opposite. So it was a shocking thing, and he was very hurt by that, and it caused some trouble on the set. He was always in character and performing at the highest levels, but off he was concerned and fighting back. It affected some of us as well because we loved him so much. But I could tell you a story about visiting a set.
Yeah.
Where I was, I can't remember which movie this was, but Herb Ross was directing, and it was Neil Simon and Walter Matthau. And I knew the first AD on it. And I asked him if I could come over to that set because I was on one nearby. And he said, yeah, come on over. I come over, and there's nothing going on. And I said, this is a bad time. He said, well, thing is that they're all in that trailer. This trailer that was on the soundstage, not outside. Big Winnebago trailer. And he said, Walter Matthau and Neil Simon and Herb Ross are arguing, right? And as he said that, I heard the first sort of, and then hits. And a fist fight broke out to the extent that the Winnebago was rocking back and forth, side to side. And they're calling out epithets, swearing at each other. And he said, you probably should get out of here. And I left, glancing back, seeing the Winnebago still going side to side with this fight. I don't know what the result of it was or why it happened, but that was probably a rough day of work.
Do you think that that often happens, that you mentioned Astin getting stories planted about him as being difficult, when a series or a film flops at the box office? Do you think that oftentimes it's sort of Hollywood suits that plant that, or is it sometimes maybe an egomaniacal director who wants to fob off whatever reason the film either fails critically or financially on, rather than, you know, what do you, is that common in the business?
I'm just going to say yes.
Yeah. Okay.
People don't know, but it's incredibly personal. They say, hey, it isn't personal, it's business.
Yeah.
Business is personal.
Yeah.
And this business, probably the music business is worse. But this business, yes, I would say that's true. I learned to be jaundiced about it when we sold our house in Beverly Hills when I was, I don't know what age, 13, 14, 15, 16, 15, I don't know, somewhere in there. We sold it to Bill Bixby, who had been in My Favorite Martian and was going to be in The Hulk.
Yeah.
And I remember him coming over and playing my guitars and flamenco. I was a big fan of his from My Favorite Martian. And my mom then showed me an article in the Hollywood Reporter describing the house Bill Bixby had just bought, which was ours, which had tennis courts and two pools, and it didn't describe our house in any way. And I said, he bought another house? She said, no. This is his publicity people trying to make it look like he's so very successful that he just got this house. There's not one truth in here.
Yeah.
And I just was, what, you can do that? Isn't this a news magazine kind of a thing? No. And they say, don't believe what you read. I see stories about temperamental actors, or I see this, or I see that. And it's always with a grain of salt ever since that day that they lied about our house.
Looking then, I see you did a Twilight Zone episode, one of the reboots from the mid-80s. And I remember that Small Talent for War, it says you in that one. That's the one where the aliens come and they're going to destroy the Earth. But it's not because we're so violent as in so many B-horror films. It was because we weren't violent enough or something. And I guess it was only, I think, a 5 or 6 minute little episode let there. Is something like that easier to act for when it's just a small 5-minute role than, say, a 22 or 24 minute sitcom or an hour long? Or does it depend really on many factors? I mean, the director or whatnot going to do 80 takes?
Generally, I would say that the smaller parts are more difficult. You don't have time to establish much. You don't have any time to develop much. I generally thrive better with more to do. And I have very little to do in that. I find those difficult. And when someone does those well, I'm always very impressed, because you have to fit into that world as though you always had been there, no questions asked. And in that case, it was somewhat difficult for me. I found that with most of the smaller roles, and you feel this pressure to make something happen, and generally it's not the best idea in the world.
Yeah. I also see, and I think the where I remembered you from, I was watching over the last few months, when I would get home or something, I would see both Night Court and MASH, and I've been trying to contact a number of the guest actors there, and I saw you did a couple of Night Court episodes. That was a very over-the-top comedy series. We talked a little bit about comedy drama before, and I think you just played, it looks like it says you played a KGB agent and then a mayor's aide in two different episodes. Is a comedy set, generally speaking, looser, or is it very serious? Because from what I've heard, you know, the stars of that show, like Anderson and John Larroquette, were both very loosey-goosey types. But some comedy people, you know, take their comedy very seriously. Is it generally, did you find, at least when you did comedic shows or sitcom, that it was an easier experience than the dramas, or is it irrelevant, you know, drama or comedy in that sense? Is it just each episode or each director?
Yeah, I did a number of sitcoms. For me, it's not a comedy-drama difference. It's a format difference. I never was comfortable on those shows. I started out in comedic roles in the movies and on television, but single-camera film shows, not multi-camera shows. And the problem for me was, and I don't know if other actors have this or not, but there's both an audience and a camera, and I couldn't figure out where to pitch my performance. Who am I playing to? It screwed up my instincts a lot. I went to go see The Associates. That's the one sitcom in which I'm semi-proud of what I did.
Yeah, and that was actually a very good sitcom. I remember when it was on, it had Martin Short. That was,
Yeah, well, I wanted to be on that show.
Yeah.
And a friend of mine was a regular, Joe Riccobuto. We'd been at NYU together. And I had gone to see it shoot the week before, and Cloris Leachman was the guest. And she was so big and getting away with it like murder. And I thought, oh, that's what you do. Not realizing I'm not Cloris Leachman. So I went there, and my rehearsals, and there's even a take in the final thing that's a little too far over the top, because I thought that's, she was so successful doing that that's what would work for me. But when we did wind up shooting it, it's probably the best performance for me that I've done on a sitcom. And part of it is that particular episode won an Emmy for writing, and it was beautifully written, so that this character is from sort of some gay alliance, and they want to show him a scene to ask the gay alliance representative if it's offensive to gay people. So I came in just talking like this and just all this sort of stuff. And the way it was written was, they asked me, and I've been talking like this, and I'm flirting with Marty Short, and they say, so is that offensive? I say, no, it's not offensive. Offensive? No. I'll tell you what's offensive. It's offensive that you expect somebody to come in here from the gay alliance talking like Sylvester the cat. That's what's offensive. That turn that they wrote was beautiful. So it allowed you to do the gay cliche thing and then turn it around and use it against those people. Well, they won an Emmy for that. That was a very satisfying, wonderful experience, and really the only sitcom I enjoyed doing.
Well, let me just ask, because you bring up a point. In the last few decades, with the sort of political correctness and multiculturalism on the rise, have you found that, or have you heard from some of the actors you've trained, you know, you obviously can't do blackface, you can't do yellowface or whatnot. And even nowadays, people want, for example, only gay actors to play gay characters. Some people have that, to me, seems to be against the essence of acting. Yeah, you can think of John Wayne trying to be Genghis Khan, and it's atrocious. Or Mickey Rooney in, what was it, when he did Breakfast at Tiffany's. That kind of thing is ridiculous. But do you think that at some points it may go overboard? Let's say for you playing a gay character or a gay character playing a straight character, at what point do you think, if there is any issue, that sometimes maybe it goes a little bit too far? And how does it differ from when you started out, you know, the culturally?
Well, it's very different culturally, for sure. You had Michael and Sarah playing Cochise.
Yeah.
So much of it was so wrong. On the other hand, Peter Sellers doing his Indian character was hysterical because it was Peter Sellers. I would say that what really this is about is that it can seem unnerving. You know, you have to be Jewish to play a Jew, you have to be black to be black, you have to be an Indian to play an Indian. What about acting those parts? I don't think it's about acting at this point. Everybody would, I think, would agree that yes, acting means you could play any part. A man could be a woman, Tootsie. What it's become about is opportunity. So if you can get a gay actor to play someone gay, giving them that opportunity, giving a black actor the opportunity, giving an Hispanic actor the opportunity, giving a woman the opportunity to play a role that might be for a man, is trying to make up, I think, for what Hollywood has been so bad at, and that is giving opportunities to underrepresented minorities and or to women. Hollywood has been really a boys' club, and exclusively so, directors, behind the camera and all that. It's been a great pleasure of my life to see behind the camera women or African-Americans or someone from another country or... And it doesn't have to do with the fact, I don't think that other people couldn't do it. It's just that other people have had so many opportunities. An actor said to me, he went to August Wilson and said, God, I would just so love to be able to be in one of your plays and say your words. And he said, and August Wilson turned to me and he said, you had yours. Shakespeare, all this other kind of stuff. This is ours.
Yeah.
I get that. I think he's right. I think opportunity has been withheld. The gates have been closed, and opening those gates is a beautiful thing. Does it mean that other people couldn't play those parts, or that part of acting isn't that? Part of acting is that. Hopefully we get to the point, and a minority actor said this to me. It's a profound thought. He said, he said there are so many mediocre white actors, but if you're a person of color, you better be the best. Not until there are a whole bunch of mediocre black and Hispanic actors, then I'll think we made real progress.
Yeah.
Like, he's hoping for more mediocre actors, right, but of color.
Yeah.
Because that would mean that we'd reach some sort of parity with the white actor. Because he's right. There are so many mediocre actors in film, television, on stage. And if you're somebody else, you better be the exemplar.
Well, it's one of those things, too, that's a double-edged sword. Because, for example, in sports, people nowadays have come along with the idea that somehow black people are greater athletes than whites or Asians or anything. But it's opportunity. I say, look at boxing. I don't know if you're a boxing fan. 100 years ago, Jews dominated, then Irish dominated, then blacks dominated. Now it's dominated by Hispanics. It's because they have the opportunity. If you don't have the opportunity to be a doctor or a lawyer, you're going to funnel in the highest talent there. I'm sure you could, you know, just look at someone if you're a baseball fan. The best player in baseball is Mike Trout. He's a white guy. But that has not, it's not because white people are dominant, just like it's about, you know, that's just a statistical fluke. But if you look at like basketball isn't that bad. Well, black players are necessarily better at basketball, but that's the easiest way for them to raise themselves up. And I know I was looking at some black actors lists when I sent around the query people, and I always see Othello on somewhere on their resume, and it's like, I like you said, the problem is they're shepherded into having to do Othello. That's the black role, generally speaking, and it's either that or playing a pimp or playing a hoochie mama or playing, you know, something like that. Now you have shows like Scandal and whatnot, and I'm not saying Scandal is high art. You know, it's a soap opera. It's fluff, and so you have fluffy, stupid black characters that aren't stupid in the JJ from Good Times kind of way, but stupid in the way that soap opera characters are stupid and make bad choices. But I've always wondered too, though. I remember growing up with the Waltons or Eight Is Enough and these good family dramas. Why aren't there dramas? I grew up in the inner city. I used to watch, for example, and Bill Cosby's verboten now, but my favorite cartoon was the Cosby Kids, Fat Albert, because those black kids lived a life closer to mine than, for example, the Waltons did. But why isn't there a black Waltons? It could be set in modern day Chicago. Why aren't there family dramas? But, you know, I've often asked, if you're an actor, or if you're taking something on, is there a way to shit blackly? Does someone walk Jewishly, as you said about walking blackly when you're doing car wash? No, everyone has these human moments that connect them up. We all take a shit and feel relief if we're constipated in the same manner. But there's this idea that somehow a black person, couldn't do a dramatic moment with their mother in a convincing way that, say, Michael Lerner did with John Boy, Richard Thomas, and the Waltons. Do you think that that's going away, or do you think that the lowest common denominator of cable and television and film today, especially film, is everything superhero, has forestalled that evolution that we get real great black roles written? Say the equivalent of a John Cassavetes films for black people or Hispanic or whatnot. Do you know what I'm saying?
I do, and I lament the loss of John Cassavetes. Nobody's making those kind of films, really, that I'm aware of. I would love to see some more of those, like A Woman Under the Influence. I think, like with all sort of cultural cross currents, that there are these cross currents. There's going to be the popular, cliche, stereotypical characters, and there's also now, I think, more closer to high art with underrepresented minorities in them. But these popular forces and the art forces have always seemed to be here at the same time, like an ocean that has currents that go different directions inside of it. It's a complex weave, I think, really, of the typical and the less typical. And cable has really, because of the narrow casting, because you don't have to do lower common denominator, you can survive in this different business model, has opened up really turbulent seas out there, and you can watch your guilty pleasure, icky, crappy show and enjoy it, and you can also watch, you know, The Wire or The Sopranos or, what was that 6 feet under.
Mad Men.
The shows like that that push ground and that have tremendous acting on them. They're coexisting at the same time.
Well, let me ask about your series Tour of Duty, and you had a recurring role on that, and I mentioned that was the other military show that I had remembered you from. Tour of Duty was, as I said, I think in the late 80s, we got a plethora of not only Vietnam films, Platoon and Full Metal Jacket. We had Apocalypse Now a little bit early, and then a Hamburger Hill or whatever. And then we got shows like Tour of Duty and China Beach. Tour of Duty was more or less all male-centered. What character did you play on that, and was that a good experience for you as an actor?
Yeah, I played a real rat, who they ironically named Major Darling. He was anything but a darling. Corrupt, stealing, sent men on dangerous missions that they really shouldn't have been going on. It was very rewarding for me as an actor. I was making a sort of transition from the kind of goofy guys that I was playing to being taken more seriously as a straight actor. And Tour of Duty helped. Some of those moments and some of those scenes and some of those shows I'm actually pleased with. The cast was great. The directors were wonderful. The producers, I really liked going to work on that show. I wanted to be on China Beach, and oddly enough, I think it's probably okay to say this now. I was also in a looping group, and I looped background voices for China Beach while I was shooting Tour of Duty, which we never told any of the producers because they would have thrown me out of the room, but I needed the money. So I would love to have been able to be on China Beach as well. Yeah. I liked the storylines. I liked the actors very much. It was wonderful. I learned a lot on it. Learned a lot about shooting with Steadicams and sort of different ways of putting these kinds of things together. And it was great. I loved it very much. The thing I'm most proud of, really, though, film-wise, is the 30-something episode I did.
Oh, yeah. I was going to mention that next, but go ahead.
Oh, yeah. No, go ahead and ask.
Well, no, I was going to say, you did a stream of, I was going to go through, you did Jake and the Fat Man, Northern Exposure, Murder, She Wrote. These are sort of archetypal 90s series, but go ahead, talk about 30-something.
Well, on 30-something, I was sent to this audition. Again, this is one of these bizarre stories, and it was, the breakdown said Irish with a quick temper. So I thought, well, I can do Irish kind of sort of conversational. It can sound as though maybe I'm sort of from Ireland and I could get it. It doesn't sound like Lucky Charms. I can get it so that it's fairly conversational. I could have a conversation with somebody and they might buy that I was Irish. So I prepared it like that. I walk into the room and there are 10 red-haired Irish guys talking amongst themselves. And I think to myself, I can't compete with them. They're Irish. I'm okay. That is real Irish. I'm screwed. I was going to call my agent, say, I got to get out of this room. And I tried to steady myself because I liked the writing so much. And I said, okay, I've got dark hair. You see me now, there's some of it left. I have dark hair. Well, I've heard of the black Irish. So I think that means dark hair. So, okay. So I thought, well, what am I going to do if I dump the accent? And I thought, I know what I'll do. I'll be my rabbi, Rabbi Feingold, because what's the difference? Rabbi, priest, they're both trying to save a soul. So what's the difference? I'm just going to talk the way I talk. I look the way I look, and yeah, I'm quick-tempered too, so that kind of fits. So I go in there, I do it, and I really enjoyed the audition, which is unusual, but it was just something that fit well. Some river that runs through me also seemed to run through that character, and we lined up. I left, And I got hired, much to my surprise, to do the part. So I got on the set and I said to the director, why did you guys hire me? You have all these Irish guys in there. He said, Richard, do you have any idea how sick we got of hearing an Irish accent? I said, no, it never occurred to me that you get sick of it. He said, well, you came in, you did it in a way we never thought of, and we didn't have to hear that Irish accent anymore, and we thought, let's go with that guy. So you just never know what's going on when you leave the room or when they make their decisions. I was going to walk away from it. And it was a real highlight for me, working with Tim Busfield and Eileen Brennan, two of the best actors maybe I've worked with. I realized I had to bring my A game to this thing. And interestingly, Timmy and I were rehearsing this, one of the scenes, and he said, let's go to my trailer. We went to his trailer, and a police guard put his arms around us and said, why don't you just hurry up into that trailer, and pushed us into Tim's trailer. We were shooting downtown L.A., and he said, so there's a sniper up on a building straight across from us here. We don't know what he's up to, so you guys just lay low, stay in here, and we'll deal with it. And we're both completely shocked. Never heard this before. And we started talking about life and death, and we started talking about religion. And the Joseph Campbell series was on about following bliss.
Yeah.
He said to me, do you think it's good to take something from each religion, or that you have a coherent view from one religion? We started talking about that. And he said to me, we're actually rehearsing, aren't we? I said, yes. He said, you know what? I'm interested in having this conversation. So when they call us over there, let's just continue this conversation, but with their words. Because I don't care whether they shoot it or they don't shoot it. I want to have this conversation. And I thought the same thing. Well, we went there, and I think it's the best work I've done in any serious TV show. Tim won the Emmy that year for that. That was one of the two shows he submitted. I was on the Emmy ballot myself, and that's what we did, and I learned something from that. I'm not going to shoot something because it's being shot. I don't care. I want to get to the point where I don't care whether they're shooting it or they're not shooting it. I want to have this interaction with this person. That changed my whole performing life, and I learned it from Tim Busfield. So we're still friends, and this is how deep an actor and how much it means to Tim. I saw him like 5 years later in an airport at the LAX. I was leaving, he was coming. I said, hey, Tim. He goes, the first words out of his mouth were, I never got that close-up right. I never got it. I said, Tim, you won the Emmy. He goes, no, I know, but I never got that close-up. That's a guy after my own heart. It's the quality of what you're doing that matters so much to him. And, you know, I'll love him for that forever.
Yeah, it reminds me of an anecdote. I'd mentioned this fellow, George Dickerson, who was on the first season of Hill Street Blues. And I can't remember off the top of my head, a guest star came on and they were doing a scene that wasn't working. And they went, I guess, to the commissary or whatnot. And he and George started, there's a fellow, it slips my mind, big name from the 50s or 60s who guested on there, but I can't remember the actor's name. And he said, well, George, what are we going to do to fix this part? And they just started talking. I think they were getting their hair done. They were in makeup or something. And they just had this natural conversation. And when they came on they said, we've got the 2 or 3 minutes that they were supposed to do the scene. He said, they went to the director and said, let's try it this way. And the director, I guess, was amenable and said, yeah, go ahead, do what you got to do. And again, it worked. So that's an interesting thing. Is that something that's that kind of thing that you did with Busfield? Was that something that is common that happens when you're doing a show or a scene? Or is that something that's unusual?
I think that was unusual.
Yeah.
I think now it's something that I want to bring to a scene. I don't need to necessarily have a conversation that's parallel. What I'm looking for is to be so engaged that and want to have this interaction so much that that I don't care where they put the camera or where the mic is or any of those things. Actually, truthfully, it's not my job. Yeah. My job is to be as unselfconscious and unaware of those things as I possibly can be. And being engaged with the other actor and being engaged with the core circumstances of what it is we're doing in the scene, that's my job.
Now, I look and see that the 90s, your at least listed roles sort of petered out. I'm wondering, did you at that point, did roles just sort of dry up for you, or did you want to go into theater? Did you want to go into teaching? And how did that course of how things have played out over the last 20 years, had you won, for example, an Emmy that year that you were nominated with Busfield, would you be here now teaching at UC Irvine, do you think, or do you think your career may have taken off in a different direction?
Well, had I won an Emmy, maybe it would have gone in a different direction. But honestly, I didn't like some of the parts I was going out on. I had a nice little run after 30-something, and Tim said to me, you're going to get a lot of calls after this, which I did. But it's a different thing. My daughter was about to enter first grade. And I had been up to Seattle to shoot Northern Exposure, and my wife at the time, I flew up with me and wanted to live up there. And I had been at the Seattle Repertory Theater back in the 70s, late 70s. And I loved it up there. And I saw how kid-friendly it was, the Seattle Center. And I was raised in Hollywood. And I walked with her, my daughter, to her first day of class in L.A. And there was a well-known movie actress walking in, looking like a superstar, and the kids had all these clothes, and she started asking me about shoes and clothes, and I walked off a set of Murder, She Wrote at Universal, just had a stupid phone call with Angela Lansbury, and then they told me Angela wouldn't be doing it, I'd be doing it with a script supervisor, and I had really taken it because I wanted to hang around with Angela Lansbury. I walked off that soundstage and I said to myself, I looked back at everything, where we'd done Petticoat and where Car Wash, well, Car Wash was on location, but it was Universal. My connection there was pretty strong. And I said, I'm never coming back here. I'm probably never coming back here. So take a look. I looked at it. I felt burned out. And I didn't want to raise my daughter here. So we moved to Seattle, and I thought, I can live off residuals for quite a while, but I'm going to need to do something else. I would love to teach. I've always had a teaching impulse. Let me see what we can do up here. Well, we were there 9 years. My daughter grew up straight and true and is working in New York at a financial institution. My marriage ended there. Also went there to save my marriage because my wife at the time said, with you or without you, I'm moving to Seattle after doing Northern Exposure. So I said, well, let me see when's a good time for me to go. That Murder, She Wrote really kind of did it for me. I just thought, no, I'm not doing this. So that's what was really behind the move. And while I was up there, I started teaching more. I had written the camera book, I think, by then, and another book by then. I've always been obsessed with acting, and I had such great teachers, I wanted to honor them too, and they're dedicated, most of my books are dedicated to Peter Olympia. And I thought I had something to offer that wasn't being taught, and it mostly isn't being taught. So I really enjoyed that teaching. And then I got on The Fugitive up there, recurring part, and it was lovely to be able to go up and shoot and then come down at night and teach and bring what I had just learned from that day of work to my class and then take the break of a class to keep from worrying about the next day's shoot. It was really mentally very healthy to be doing both. my friend Jeff Perry, who's on Scandal, tries to do that too. But working on Scandal in his role is difficult for him to teach, but he keeps trying to offer classes and continue to keep that balance going, which he has his whole life. And I get it completely because of how much richer it made me doing both of those things in Seattle. So I wound up doing some more acting, and this job at UC Irvine for an acting camera teacher came up, and I thought, well, I have to apply for that. That's just stupid. I mean, if I don't, all I want is a second interview. And I did get a second interview. I thought, okay, well, that's that. And then they called and said, would I like to come down to the school and meet people? And I had like 7 or 8 hoops to jump through. I had to do a sample class. I had to give an academic lecture. I had to meet the dean. I had to meet with the grad students. I had to meet with the search committee over 2 days. And I said to my new wife, Melissa, I said, I don't even know if I want this job. I just wanted to find out if I could get a second interview, because I should get a second interview. I called up a friend at the University of Washington, and I said, what does it mean when they say they want you to come down and meet? He said, oh, that means it's down to 3 or 4 people. You're in the final group. I was like, oh, all right, I guess I'll go down and see what it's like. I don't really want to do this. And they called, and I got the gig. We were going to move to LA anyway, and I was going to open up a private studio. But this came through, so I took it. I really liked my colleagues, which was unusual. I'm still there. I mean, I ask myself each year, am I going to go back, or should I go back? You know, I'm going to have to get an agent again, and I have to audition for people. And do I really want to put myself through that again? And a part of me does. Well, doesn't want to, but will. And every year it's a decision. I'm making it now. Am I going to go back? They've made me head of acting now, so I have more administrative responsibilities, which I don't love. The word that's often accompanied head is ache. I feel like headache of acting. But I'm learning it. I'm just finishing my first year as head of the program. So that's how all that really transpired.
Well, now, I've seen that you've done some stage in the interim. Is that doing some stage work just for UC Irvine, or have you taken some acting gigs, you know, during time off?
Yeah, I've taken some gigs in my time off. The Shakespeare, Merchant of Venice, and King Lear were on the Irvine campus. It's a separate, sort of allied professional summer Shakespeare festival that started 5 years ago, and I did the inaugural season there, and then a season or two after that I got to do a musical. I got to be in the Fantastics. The stage will always be my first love. You get to go from beginning to end. It puts you through a lot, and I love the camera. I think of it as a 20th century style, like restoration or these different kinds of styles. It has its own jargon. It has its own techniques. And I love it. But I don't love them equally, really. I think I love being on stage a little bit more. My instincts have gotten better for the camera, but they're more learned. The stage came more naturally to me. But film and television has taught me the virtue of restraint on stage. And Alan Rickman talked about that as well, that it had taught him the same thing. And I think it's one of the great lessons that I've gotten from film and TV acting, because I was told it would ruin your stage acting. You'll just become so small, you can't fill a house. None of which was true. You wind up playing the size of the house you're in. Your voice rises to the occasion, your body does, but without losing connection to that authenticity. And that's what I didn't understand. When I saw the Robards do it, and when I saw one of those guys in the Cassavetes crew. Not Peter Falk, but Ben Gazzara.
Gazzara.
I saw Ben Gazzara in Virginia Woolf on Broadway, directed by Albee. And I saw George C. Scott on stage. And I didn't know that you could be more or less film level, knowing you were on stage, and include the audience in an intimate performance that made the other actors look like they were wooden soldiers or something. He didn't make Colleen Dewhurst look that way, but pretty much everyone else on stage. And George C. Scott made everyone else on stage look like they were cardboard cutouts. And he wasn't raising his voice. He wasn't doing his George C. Scott rage that he can do so beautifully like in Patton. But Patton is a quiet performance almost all the way through. Then there's that explosion. And in the hospital, his extraordinary monologue, it's quiet and it's intimate. He was that way on stage, and it read to the back row.
Yeah.
I didn't know that was possible. Those things came from film and television for me, and from seeing it proven to me by those actors, and it changed my stage performances all for the better.
Yeah, I know. I never got a chance to see any big name actors on stage, but I, you know, robots I know from film, and I remember actually as a child, 72 or 73, he did a Christmas special called A Home Without a Christmas Tree, and he played the father of this young girl back in the Depression who didn't have a Christmas tree. And I remember watching his performance as the father, who was very strict and whatnot, and by the end of the film, the girl convinces him to let them have just a little Christmas tree in the home because he was a widower and Christmas reminded him of his dead wife. But I remember thinking, boy, that's acting like I never saw before. You know, not that I didn't see great acting on, say, The Odd Couple. I think Klugman and Randall were a great comedy team. But dramatic acting on television there, I still remember that role of Robots, which is probably forgotten amongst his list of dozens of great roles. But let me just ask a final question in this segment, and then we'll wrap up the interview, and I'll give you some closing remarks on whatever you want to talk about. But since you have now become a teacher and you talk about still having some of the yearnings to be an actor, is there a didactic impulse that strikes you when you have some students performing a scene? Is there that part of you that wants to say, no, watch out, kid, this is how you do it? How do you balance the didact versus the creative impulse?
Well, you know, that does come up.
Yeah.
I try very much not to say, do it like this, don't you see? I have done it because a teacher said to me, hey, you know, modeling something for a student is not always bad.
Yeah.
So I do it with, I try to be judicious about it. Peter once said a thing about acting teachers that sometimes they're teaching, which means giving you a process take out of here that you can use on any part. Sometimes they're coaching, which is trying to lead somebody toward a choice that they'd like you'd like them to make. And sometimes they're just flat out directing, telling you what the hell to do and what choice to make. And acting teacher is very slippery in this. And you need to be clear with your students, and your students need to be clear with you, which one you're doing at this particular moment. And the other one is, are you working on the role right now, or are you working on them right now? They need to know what you're actually working on and what you're doing. That clarity is very helpful in trying to stay out of their way. I kind of do both. Like the tide, Joe Chaykin called it, I wash in sometimes and take over the land. And then you need to know when to recede and let the land take over. That's a day-by-day, scene-by-scene, even moment-by-moment calculation that acting teachers have to make. And the really great ones do it a very high percentage of the time. I never saw Peter not do it. Yeah. I can't do what Peter could do. I never saw Olympia not do it. I'm not those two. It's okay. Peter said to me, you have to sing the music in your own voice. And told me that I now did. But if you're not ever vigilant about this, the power of being an acting teacher, everybody looks up to you. Everybody's banking their career on you. Their success on you can be a kind of absolute power that is ridiculously corrupting. And I'm well aware of it. And when I step a little too far, some bell goes off inside of me, and I step back. I may even have to apologize to the actor and move on from there to the student. When I tried directing, which is why I don't direct, I turned into Hitler. I go here, wait 3 seconds, turn here, pick that up. Here's how it's done. And I realized, wow, where did that come from? Okay, so that's there. I stay away from directing because of it.
Yeah. I just wanted to clarify when I was talking about the Robards scene, and I don't know if you ever saw that, because you're a few years older, so you probably don't remember it. But one of the things that's interesting is when I was a kid, I grew up in a bad neighborhood. I remember when I was about 6 years old, I saw someone killed. And I remember the moment when the person died, their eyes were open. And even though nothing actually physically changed, I knew the moment that person died. And there's a scene in that House Without a Christmas Tree with Jason Robards, who had that great sort of hangdog face. And he's hard, and he's sort of like the Grinch who stole Christmas. And the daughter finally brings the tree in, and he's about to raid. And I think it's maybe his mother-in-law is living with them at the time. And Robards is looking at this little Christmas tree, and we know as a viewer that he's thinking of his dead wife. And his expression doesn't change, but everything changes. At some point, there's like, you know, the moment when the dramatic moment occurs, and nothing physically that you could say changes. But Robards was such a good actor that just with his eyes and his body, just you knew that something had changed internally in the character. And that to me is always a sign of great acting. And it's odd because I was 7 or 8 when I first saw that. And even though I didn't know intellectually, I knew there was something different, and different meaning better, about his acting than in most of the acting that I saw on TV or movies at that moment. But I just wanted to clarify what it was there. But let's end this segment, and in the final segment, I'll give you a few minutes to just wrap up some of your thoughts. I've been speaking for the last couple of hours with Richard Brestoff. He is an actor and an acting professor at University of California, Irvine. We've talked a bit about his career, about acting in general. You know, it's interesting as I do these series of interviews, seeing the connections. You spoke about being in The Fantastics, and a woman named Carol Demas was in the original production of The Fantastics in the 60s that I interviewed. And then you mentioned your father being a classically trained violinist. Yesterday, when I spoke with Stephanie Kramer, who was also in The Man with Two Brains, her father was a classically trained violinist. And so it's just interesting, these little connections. You mentioned the Dorsey brothers, and it brought me back to my dad, who was a big Jimmy. I forget whether he preferred Jimmy or Tommy Dorsey, but anyway... let me just give you a few moments, if you could sort of wrap up some of your thoughts or give any piece of advice to, say, a young actor watching this just about anything that comes to your mind, whether it's the business or the craft.
Yeah, so there's something I read from Elia Kazan in his incredibly long book, A Life, where he said, there's something about a genuinely felt performance that a simulated one, no matter how well simulated, just doesn't have. I feel this about acting, that we experience the role we play, and that we try to personalize in character. And that what I see a lot of is people demonstrating their understanding of the part, presenting that, but not entering into it with their heart, their soul, and their mind. They're not experiencing it. And the genuinely felt performance has something. And you know when it happens. You saw Robards do it. I saw Robards do it. There's that connection to some underground aquifer that's feeding everything that grows from it. And to me, shaping that personalizing in character and shaping it. The horse and the rider are what we do at our best. Stanislavski's analogy is with grapes and wine, that our emotional life, if we don't value it, we have to value and celebrate, not just value it, celebrate our emotional lives so we bring it to our work. That's the grapes from which we craft the different kinds of wines. But if we don't cultivate these grapes, our lives, our reaction to our lives, feel our lives deeply and use those alchemically to transform them into what we do, then I'm not interested in the actor. Meryl Streep said, what I do is I look for what's apparently different in the character and find myself in there. That's coming at it a different way. It's the same thing. If you aren't bringing yourself to the role, what you make will be dead. We watch a lot of it. A lot of it is simulated. And it's okay. It gets the job done. But it's not a revelation. And what I miss, what we need, is revelatory acting. Not competent. Sometimes, look, a gig is just a gig and there's not going to be any revelation in it. For me, The Twilight Zone or any number of shows. But that's not satisfying. That's not what we're looking to be or do. So that's what I have to say.
Well, I want to thank you for spending a few hours speaking with me. Anyone who's interested in Richard, either as a teacher or an actor, I'm going to have links to his IMDb page and its UCI page as well. You can contact him at your leisure. So again, thank you for your time and your words.
Thank you, Dan. Is there a URL to which I can find this interview?
Yes, I will send it. I'll send a link to you once it's over. Yeah.
Oh, great. Okay. Thank you so much for this opportunity. I obviously love to talk about acting, and I love what you're doing, and I've listened to a number of your interviews outside of the acting area, too. And your intelligence, inquisitiveness, and your genuineness really come across, and I really thank you for it. I think you're doing a wonderful thing with this site.
Well, one of the things that I wanted to do with these interviews, the three main interviews that I know online are like the Actor Studio, which I think has lost its moorings from its original way. They've sometimes had 10 or 12 people on in an hour show, and how the hell can you talk about acting? And then there's the SAG interviews, which sometimes are good, but a little bit on the celebrity side and sometimes about the SAG. And then there's the Emmy Legends interviews. And while they are very good and detailed, they're more historical and biographical rather than art. And so I think there's a need. One of the things I've said to a few people off camera, and I'll say this on camera, is it's often frustrating, especially on the lowest common denominator medium like YouTube, where, you know, E equals MC squared can be explained by Einstein as a chipmunk and get 25 million hits in 2 months. And here I can have 2 hours of speaking with an intelligent human being about an art, or sometimes when I've done shows on philosophy or science or whatnot, and I'll get maybe 200 or 300 in the first few years. But I'm in it for the long haul. I think, you know, 15, 20 years, these are going to be more relevant than Einstein the chipmunk. So thanks again.